There was a rumour going around about an Irish actor, Colm, who was in a play in London and had to shave his head. Would you be able to tell me anything about that?
Yeah, it's actually, well, it's about the 74 final. The actor was me, and I was doing a play in London. I think it was called The History of the 10th Struggle or something. Anyway, I was playing Lynn Biel, and I had to shave my head, because Lynn Biel was bald, and I shaved my head.
Yeah.
And I was kind of going around London, you know, with a shaved head. And I'd seen, like, my reflection and things, like in the tube going home or something, pull out of the station, you see the dark thing. And I'd look around and say, who's that baldy? And then I'd be, oh, it's me. So, come the surprise, we're in the All-Ireland final. I'm doing a play in London. And the only place I could see it was in the Hammersmith Odeon, as they called a closed circuit television in those days on the big screen.
Sure.
And I went to this match with Stephen Ray, and the two of us walked up there to the Hammersmith Odeon, and about 2,500, 3,000 people watching this game from all counties in Ireland. This is when I realised that every county in Ireland hates us. They'll cheer for anyone against us.
Oh my God.
So they're from every 31 other counties, they're all there cheering for Galway. I'm the only one cheering for Dublin. Anytime Dublin do something, I jump up and I'm the only one, right? And I hear these voices behind me saying, tell that baldy fucker to sit down. No. And Stephen was pulling me sleeves, saying, sit down, Colm, sit down. I said, don't, they're talking about me, they're talking about some baldy fucker.
I remember Dublin City in the rare old times.
The 1950s was a glorious time for Dublin football. Who could ever forget the passion and emotion of the 1955 loss to Kerry? And for the first time, Hill 16 was a sea of blue.
Without making excuses for 55 or that, we were a little bit unfortunate in that in the week prior to the game, we lost three of our strongest guys, physically strongest guys. We lost Jim McGuinness, who played a half an hour in the final with a damaged knee and should never have been on the field. We lost Mark Wilson, who was a big strong defender. We lost Norman Allen, who was a big strong defender, and I always felt they had a crucial impact on the game.
Yeah, the 1955 All-Ireland. I mean, that was. Kevin himself wasn't fit for that match at all.
No, that's without making any excuse. On the day, there was no doubt about Kerry were the better side.
In 1955, the football Dublin were playing was pure football, short passing, very attractive. Based on mobility, players swapping positions and whatever, and it was great. But when the crunch came and he played Kerry in the final, the old traditional values of catch and kick, Kerry playing route one football, Kerry were playing the kind of Gaelic football then that Jack Charlton played with the soccer team and managed 40 years later.
Whatever deficiencies in physicality we might have had 55, we certainly had them corrected by 58.
After a false start due to Kevin Heffernan's enthusiasm, Simon Dagenham got the game going and the battle was on for Ireland's greatest prize.
And it would always have been my belief after that, as the good Lar Foley used to say, you needed a deterrent.
However, the Derry hopes were rudely shattered 2 minutes later. Desi Ferguson sends to Paddy Farnan, Tommy Doherty slips and Farnan beats Patsy Gormley. Dublin are again 3 points ahead. Then comes the final blow. The centre comes to Johnny Joyce and he coolly crashes home Dublin's second goal, and to make quite certain of it, Paddy Farnan adds it, a finishing touch.
So as the spot we're standing in here must bring back huge memories for all of you.
My earliest memory of the school actually is down here where there's a building now. There used to be an iron stairs up
right.
On the outside,
yeah.
And there's a grass patch. And any time I think of Marino, I think of after the 58 final when Des and the lads came with the cup.
Yeah.
And I can still see Des. He was kind of a very proud figure, and immediately he became a hero of mine.
A less flamboyant Dublin team won the All-Ireland in 1963, but then the rot set in. Dublin football went into free fall.
Did you feel that you were kind of like in a rebuilding process, that you were young guys coming into a team that would
that you were starting from the ground up again in the mid-60s? Or?
Well, you know, I would think that the game wasn't as serious in those days. So there were lots of serious characters involved in, like Lara Foley, John Timmins and Des Foley, and they all had their own particular styles, you know, and the team wasn't as organized. When it got into the 70s, there was a more professional approach taken to the whole thing by everybody.
Sean O'Callaghan rang me one day, and he said, have you made any decision yet about the inter-county selectors? Oh, I said, yeah. I said, I've asked Kevin Heffernan and Donald Colfer and Larkin Redmond.
Jimmy Gray and Jim King were the leading lights on the county board side of things, and I suspect that Kevin Heffernan indicated the type of management structure he required. As a result of that, he was put in charge, he was the manager, and Donald Colfer and Larkin Redmond joined him by selection.
Donald Colfer and Larkin Redmond played a huge part. Right from the beginning, like they were involved with club teams, with Sing Street and with St. Margaret's, and they were very knowledgeable about players around the county. They were the guys, I'd say, who put together the first panel.
And peculiarly enough, the triumvirate served a great purpose, because sometimes a manager can't get through or speak to everybody, but one of the three could always reach some player.
Well, Mick Dunn, Lord Mercy, may I remember Mick used to, in RTE, Mick used to always say that Dublin with the light blue and the white shorts was not satisfactory for television. And he said you should do something like Dunn. So, I forget some match we played, I can't remember what match we played. Paula being a woman, she came along, she got the contrast right, you know, the dark and blue, and she was the one that thought it up.
And I just thought at the time that Dublin would look better in blue and navy. And
it is.
I did a sketch and gave it to him, and he put it to the management committee. So they agreed and went with it.
But it caused ructions at the county board, breaking with tradition, and we just through an oversight, we never thought of telling them that the jerseys, the style, the kit was going to be changed, you know. Those were.
Yeah. And I remember as a kid hearing a story about the kit, that the reason Dublin wore kind of sky blue as opposed to a different colour was that sometime in the 40s or something, Dublin used to wear kind of a royal blue, a darker blue.
Yes.
And that the kit person washed the jerseys, yeah, bleached them or something.
Bleached them and they came out
sky blue.
Yeah.
Is that true?
That is true, yeah. When the colours were changed in 74, the Dublin Corporation followed suit with the flag, and they had the flags Dublin.
So the city flag changed from blue and white to blue and navy?
Yeah, blue and navy, yeah. Mm. So automatically they did it, you know, which...
And as a flag, do you think the blue and navy looks better than the blue and white as well?
Absolutely, yeah.
I think we should have a referendum in Dublin about this. What do you think?
Well, I don't know.
Bad old days before 74, it was bad enough like going to Croke Park and seeing very small crowds, but on the road it must have been miserable for Dublin, because nobody could be bothered travelling to follow them, could they?
Absolutely. One of the blessings, or one of the indirect rewards of that particular year, was Dubliners got to know, some of Dubliners got to know a place in the country never knew existed. Like, for example, Kilkenny. Dublin football team, to my knowledge, had never ever played in Kilkenny until they... Being in Division 2, they had to go down for a match in Nolan Park in, I think it was December 1973.
Wow.
Now, can you picture, a Kilkenny football team has the same riveting effect, I would think, as a wet Monday morning.
I was surprised to see so many cars and evidence of a crowd around the place. When we went in, I said to somebody, God, football must be making a great surge in Kilkenny. Then I realised, it was the start of the county minor hurling final, the time was 2 o'clock. We were to play at 2:30. So I said to Paddy Grace, who was county secretary at the time, I said, Paddy, we're supposed to play at 2:30. And his answer to me was, well, if you want the points, you can have them. So after that, I just sat back and waited for the hurlers to finish. And as soon as the game was over, the crowd got up and all bar about a dozen, went home about their business and left us to play on an icy cold evening. It was so cold that even the scoreboard man went home at half time.
Jimmy and I worked together in Abbey Street, and we were coming back on the bus, And Jimmy was going on, Jimmy was like, I'm going to talk to this fella tomorrow, and he's slagging the arse off me, and he's this, that, and the other. And I was sitting listening to Jimmy bemoaning the fact that he was going to see this fella tomorrow, obviously from Kildare or wherever. They'd beaten us in the first round of the championship, which we were beaten in every year. And I remember sitting there thinking to myself, nobody knows I play for Dublin. And I was meeting people, we were out on the road, and I was going to meet people tomorrow. And all the people I was thinking of that I had to meet and appointments and so on, none of them knew I played for Dublin, and I wouldn't tell them.
We were in a poor state. We were playing second division football after being relegated to second division, and we went out of the championship pretty early that year. So we had a full summer with nothing to do, and I think Kevin Heffernan was brought in around that stage. And he had a meeting then around the end of 73. And he had about 45 or 50 of us together in the Hollybrook Hotel. And he asked us, were we prepared to give a commitment to play football for Dublin? And when he asked for a commitment, he actually meant it.
There was a programme then, Paddy Crosby's school around the corner, and Paddy asked one of the kids who was on the programme one time, he said, what did you do yesterday, son? He said, I went to a match. And he said, who was playing? And he said, Dublin. And Paddy said, and who were they playing? He said, Colchi, sir. and that was the secret of it. Yeah. It was the GAA at that point, and indeed to some degree still exists, on tribalism.
Jimmy, I think you took a bit of a break from Intercounty before 74, did you?
I missed the 73 championship.
Did you? Yeah.
And
is it true that Kevin Heffernan went down to find you in Vincent's club playing cards one night have a chat with you?
I was enjoying life, was playing away with Vincent's and doing a wee bit of training. And then Friday night I used to go down to Vincent's, and they were giving cards a few points. He introduced this Saturday morning training, and I continued going down to Vincent's. So he arrived on Friday night and he says to me, look, he says, obviously you're not taking this serious. I said, what's wrong with you? He said, you're having a few points there and you're training tomorrow morning. I said, that'd be okay. So I went home anyway, I thought all about it. And I decided to take it easy on the Friday night, but I just didn't stop him coming down, looking for me on the Friday night, and the lads were telling me, he's down in Mars in Ballybock, and he can stand down, drive down to Mars.
I don't know, it had to be innate, because it wasn't the amount of practice he did.
Jimmy Keaveney takes it, and Jimmy Keaveney sends it over the bar. Jimmy Keaveney. And Jimmy Hyatt over the bar and the lead for Dublin. And that is about 50 metres out from the down goal. Jimmy Keaveney up for this one. Gets inside Mark Turley, takes his shot and sends it over. No, yes it is, it's over the bar.
Particularly in place kicking or free kicking or that, they have to practice it quite a lot. So there's a repetition to it. But it wasn't with Jimmy. Jimmy had this innate ability that place ball or from his hands, once he had reasonable space, and he was tremendously quick over a very short thing. He wasn't into endurance training. I mean, he wasn't built for the long haul.
Jimmy said, Kevin Heffernan one night, Kevin, I'm a pain in my arse.
No, I didn't say that.
And I don't know what it is. I don't know what it is, he said, but I can't train. Kevin said, go in and have a shower. And he pulled the trick so many times.
I had a problem with a hamstring problem. And even Heffernan used to make skit out of my hamstring. And I don't be vulgar, but it did start right in the cheekbone. That's where it starts, on your bone. That's where your hamstring starts. And I had a problem with that. But
you didn't know what it was.
Excuse me, at the time I didn't know what it was. And like, if I got into a car and I was driving as far as, say, Carlo or Portlaoise, I'd get as far as Naas. I had to get out of the car and walk around because it was tightening up me. So Paul O'Neill in the end, I'm telling the story.
Very young company.
So Paul O'Neill in the end, he brought me, he was in Stevens at the time, Dr. Stevens Hospital.
Paul O'Neill.
Yeah, Dr. Pat. Right. And he brought me to see this specialist, and he looked at me, and he said, Jimmy, it's your hamstring, and it's most unusual for an athlete.
A
footballer.
A footballer.
But you didn't know what a hamstring was.
Hold on, will you please? To get it where I was getting it. And he was saying to me, by the way, he said, Jimmy, if you continue on hard training, that's going to slip off the bone in your bum and run down your leg, and it's going to be a big operation.
This is
the truth. And Pat will verify this for you.
Rudyard Kipling.
And I used it for years.
Was it a condition that was common to any other profession besides that?
No, I think it happened. It didn't happen to athletes, but it could happen to people.
Yeah.
Like you.
Like Jimmy.
But in fairness, towards the end of my career, and I haven't had a problem with it since. No.
As a curtain raiser to the replayed league final between Roscommon and Kerry, Dublin played Wexford in the first round of the championship. Our story begins.
I think our expectations against Wexford were much higher than the performance we gave. We expected to beat Wexford. Having had a reasonably good league in the sense that we had got a team together playing cohesively and with a bit of confidence.
Did that sort of upset you guys that you were a curtain raiser?
Well, I think it put in perspective our standing in the world of football, Colin, at the time. I think it was appropriate enough, curtain raiser to big teams like Roscommon. So it was a bit of an insult, but I think it was appropriate enough.
Yeah. And did you have any idea when you stepped out, like the beginning of the 74 Championship, that there was of the momentous?
No, I mean, I think we were very fit, a lot better prepared than from the year before. But nothing special. I mean, this was our yearly outing in the championship. And
well, you might get a game or two.
Yeah, well, the second game was always a big bonus in those days.
Did you think, like, at the end of 73 or the beginning of 74, that this was going to be your year? Or was it just...
No. Colin, we got lucky breaks. One in particular, in 74, Les Deegan was playing Offaly, and I think it was the Leinster semi-final.
That was a quarter-final.
Quarter-final. Mm. And... Mm. Offaly were going for three or four Leinster championships on the trot, and Les got a fabulous goal that day, and he kicked the winning point, practically the last kick of the game. Now, if that point hadn't gone over and had been a draw, he probably would have beaten us in the replay. We wouldn't be heard of.
1 minute to go. Sean Lowry gets Offaly downfield. Ball broken down to Stephen Rooney, to Brian Mullen, into Leslie Deegan. Can Doug Deegan save Dublin? He sends it over the bar. And Dublin are ahead.
Some scores were level. Stephen Rooney robbed the ball in the middle of the field, delivered the ball, which Les Deegan captured. And I say Les was probably the only player we had who could kick the actual ball to get the point that he got. As at least four Offaly defenders descended upon him.
I remember after that game, I remember feeling there's something going to happen here.
To the Leinster final, and we felt, well, you know, we have one cup under our belt already, which was the Corner of Cosca, which we had collected. And when we were coming off the steps at that Easter Sunday, we said, look, there's a Leinster final coming up. We may have another one. But that was the end of that talk. We took each game as it came along after that.
Whatever group dynamic we had created, it worked for us that day, and we actually won the match. I wouldn't say comfortably, but we actually won it, which was a great achievement because it was our first time out against Meath, and it was the first time for a lot of us to deal with the whole occasion of a Leinster final. Mm. And
were the crowd starting to grow then?
Oh,
it was a big crowd
of
that Leinster final.
It would have been, yeah. And I would say that, you know, it was a balance between a lot of people who were associated with Dublin football, maybe not going to the match because they thought Meath would win. And a lot of other people who were associated with Dublin football saying, I think we'll go today. This might be the day. For them, it was the day,
magic.
You know.
Yeah.
Now then, after that, everybody wanted to be there every day.
It's true to say there was a void in Dublin among the sporting public before the arrival of the Dubs and Heffo's army. There was no League of Ireland team to latch onto. Shamrock Rovers, the dominant team of the 60s, were no longer the force they were. And the rugby team would have to wait until the next decade. And the Triple Crown wins of 82 and 85. The Irish soccer team, while getting respectable results at home and European and World Cup qualifiers, would have to wait until 1986 and the appointment of Jack Charlton to lead them into the promised land. So simply put, the Dubs were the only show in town.
There was still a big attendance here for live sport, and it was a floating, it would go where the best value was. Nothing was happening. And then Dublin came along then in 70.